All right, now that we have seen improbable differential cryptanalysis, now we can see the improbable differential attacks applied on the block cipher Calafia. So let's recall what the Calafia cipher looks like. Calafia was designed by Sony Corporation, actually by academicians that work in Sony Corporation. And it is ISO IEC standard for lightweight block cipher since 2012. So this standard was, I think, first announced in 2012, but last year it was reviewed, and Calafia is still in this set of standards. So in 2012, there were two block ciphers that were standards, Present and Calafia, but recently they added LIA to this set. So there are now three lightweight block ciphers standardized by ISO. And Sony uses it for digital rights management. And the name of the cipher comes from the French word clé, which means key in French, but I don't know why they used they are inspired by this French word. So the block size of Calafia is 128 bits, and it supports three different key sizes for different security levels. So these are, like in the case of AES, 128 bits, 192 bits, and 256 bits. And depending on the key size, the number of rounds changes. For the smallest key size, we have 18 rounds. And so far, the best known attack on Calafia 128 breaks 13 out of 18 rounds of this cipher. And we are going to see this attack in a minute. So let's look at the general picture of this block cipher. It is a generalized phase test structure. So recall that like normal phase test ciphers like this, we would see two lines here representing right and left. But in this case, we have four lanes. So this is why we call it a generalized phase test structure. Calafia, as we just seen, has a block size of 128 bits. So each line here actually represents 32 bits. So you can think this like a two phase ciphers divided in the middle, but idea is as follows. The left part is fed inside a function called F0, and round key 0 is also used in this F function, and the output is XORed with the second word, but there's also a whitening key XOR here. And similarly, same thing happens here, but this time instead of F0, we have F1 here, which are very similar functions that we are going to see in a minute. So from the secret key, these whitening keys and round keys are obtained. Okay, so at the end, we obtain the ciphertext. Like in the most phase test ciphers, in the last round, we don't perform this swap operation of the words because it doesn't provide any security or it doesn't have any cryptographic importance. So the picture is really simple. Of course, what is important is what's inside this F0 and F1 function. So we can plot them like this. The F0 function, which takes 32 bits input, is divided into 4 bytes. And each byte is XORed with the corresponding round key byte. Then 8x8 S boxes, S0 and S1, are applied to these 4 bytes. And at the end, there is a matrix multiplication M0 here. So the output 32 bits are provided here. F1 looks very similar to F0, but as you can see, instead of the order of the S boxes like S0 and S1, we have S1, S0, S1, S0 in this case. And instead of the matrix M0, here we use M1. And these matrices also look very similar. And these are the hexadecimal representation of those matrices. So as you can see, there is a key addition layer inside this F function. Then there is the confusion layer provided by two different S boxes. And then the diffusion is obtained by the matrix multiplication. Now let's look at the best impossible differential attacks in the literature and see how they were extended to improbable differential attacks. So The best impossible differential attacks on the cipher was introduced by Tsuno et al. And in their first analysis, they provided 9-round impossible differentials. So their idea is as follows. They provided the following input difference, saying that the first three words has no difference. And in the final work, they give a difference to the first byte of the 32 bits. So if you go back to the picture, so do you have a plain text here? So you only modify the leftmost byte here. And they observed that after 9 rounds of encryption, the output cannot be cannot have the following difference, which is again 0-0, but this time there is a non-zero difference in the second byte, but not in the first byte. So this is one of the 9-round impossible differentials they obtained, and this is the similar one. This time, instead of this byte, you give the difference to this byte. So they use these two 9-round impossible differentials, and they added some rounds to the top and bottom of these 9-round differentials to attack 12 rounds of Clavier. So now let's see how they were expanded to improbable differentials as follows. So they the improbable differential attacks use these 9-round impossible differentials. So this will be in the middle of our attacks. So let's look at how they work. So we obtain 10-round improbable differentials by adding the following 1-round differentials to the top of these 9-round impossible differentials. So as you can see, the right part is the same as the input of the impossible differentials. So we are adding actually 1 round to the top of this 9-round impossible differential. So we observe that this input goes to this output difference after 1 round. So as you can see, we are giving 1 byte difference to the leftmost lane, and we are giving a non-zero difference here to the second word. As you can see, if we go back to the picture, so we are giving the input difference to the leftmost byte, but as you can see, this difference will go here, and without having any, without being affected, it goes here and matches with our 9-round impossible differential. But also our 9-round impossible differential has zero difference here, but we put a input difference here. So we should choose it so that after the application of this F0, they should cancel each other. So this is why, as you can see, for the 1-round differential, we start with non-zero value here, but this somehow canceled out and becomes zero difference, because this difference somehow cancels this. So this way, by looking at the DDT table of the S boxes, we choose these differences accordingly. And a similar thing can be applied to the other non-round impossible differential. So if we choose these differences depending on the difference distribution table of the S0, because this difference is input to S0. So by looking at the DDT table, you can choose the best values for these differences. And closed look shows that the best thing is the average of this cancellation probability is 2^-5.87. So P prime becomes this probability. So if we recall, what does this mean? We already know that this difference does not go to this difference, but now we are saying that this difference goes to this one with probability 2^-5, that's something. So this way, we obtain a 10-round improbable differential, saying that this difference most probably will not go to this one. So this way, instead of the 9-round impossible differential, now we have 10-round improbable differential. So we obtain 1 round longer distinguisher. So we will use this to attack 1 more round. So we put 1 additional round on the plaintext side and 2 additional rounds on the ciphertext side of the 10-round improbable differential to attack first 13 rounds of Clavier that captures round keys RK1, RK2, and 3, XORed with the whitening key, and RK24 and RK25. So the picture becomes something like this. Recall that this is our input difference of 10 round improbable differential. And at the end, we don't expect to see this output difference. So in order to add more rounds, now you have to, if for instance, if you are adding one round to the top of this distinguisher, we have to go back one round backwards with probability one and see that what can be the input difference if one round later they are going to become something like this. So if you look closely, this zero difference has to go here and this has to have a zero difference. And this one goes here. And also this zero difference will still have zero difference because this is a bijection. So as you can see, this difference is identical to this one. So from here, we have the same difference and we have zero difference here, but this difference will turn into something that we don't know. So we simply denoted it by X, which means something non-zero. So a similar thing has to be applied to the bottom. So again, this zero difference goes here and this one goes here and so on and so forth. Okay. So this way, when you are going to attack 13 rounds, what you are going to do is as follows. You need to capture, so assume that somebody is using 13 round clef here. So you have to capture pairs which have this input difference and which have this output difference. So this, since this is a chosen plaintext attack, you have to capture those plaintext to perform the attack. Once you capture those, what you are going to do is next is as follows. Guess the necessary round keys and whitening key bits so that you can partially encrypt these pairs one round and check if this input difference of the distinguisher is observed. If it is observed, then for the same pair, go backwards with a guessed again round keys, decrypt it two rounds back and see if this output difference is observed. So if it is observed, just increase the counter of that key. So you have to repeat this process for every pair we captured and for every candidate round key bits. So we have to keep a counter for those round key bits. And at the end of the attack, the round key which has the least number of hits, so the round key with the smallest counter should be the correct key. So as you can see here, we are attacking round key bits, but we haven't mentioned how these round key bits are obtained from the key schedule. But before moving on to that, let's see what has changed once we expanded the impossible differential attack to the improbable differential attack. So the original impossible differential attack by Tsuno et al. Was on 12 rounds, but now we turned that attack into 13 rounds. But as you can see, the data complexity of their attack was lower than ours because, as we mentioned before, converting an impossible differential to an improbable differential introduces some probability. So in order to distinguish these two distributions, you have to use more data so that you can more successfully distinguish them. This is why the data complexity increases, but since we are performing encryption on all of these data, the time complexity also increases. And instead of single bits, now we have to store counters for every key, candidate key. So this is why we have more memory complexity than the previous one. But of course, our gain is instead of 12 rounds, now we can break 13 rounds. So if you move on to other key sizes, for instance, when you move on to the key length 192, again, we improve the Tsuno et al's 13 round attack to 14 round attack, and their 14 round attack on Clefia 256 into a 15 round attack, which has data complexity very close to the whole code book. So this is, as you can see, attacks always gets better. We mentioned this before. So this is one way of seeing how it got a little bit better. But now let's see how these attacks were even further improved in the literature. So first improvement come from again Tsuno et al. they observed that they can obtain better nine-run impossible differentials. So they made this discovery in 2008. So they started again with a similar input difference, but this time they say that after nine runs of encryption, the output difference cannot be in this form. So as you can see in our previous nine runs impossible differentials, we had only one non-zero byte value. Now we have two. So this actually gives us more candidates in this scenario. So this way we can have more freedom when performing the attack. Okay, so they obtained better impossible differentials. So they improved their own impossible differential attacks. But this way we can also use the same, these observations and improve the improbable differential attacks, so which we already did years ago. But before only mentioning that improvement, another thing was observed. So far, these impossible and improbable differential attacks assume that the round keys are independent. So we haven't given an attack on the master secret key, but we are trying to capture the round key bits. So we assume that they are just independent. But the key schedule of Clavier simply uses constant addition and bit swapping operation. So after some point on, by looking at the bits, you might observe some dependencies between bits of different round keys. So some round keys have common bits or just XOR with a constant. For example, for Clavier 128, round key 1 and round key 24 have 22 common bits. So this observation allowed other people to obtain better impossible differentials, but we also use the same observation to have better improbable differential attacks. So in this picture, I'm actually showing you the so far the best attacks on Clavier. So these are the first three rows, this one and this one, actually the ones we just mentioned before. As you can see, Tsuno improved their own attack by reducing the data and time complexity by using the better impossible differentials. And some people use the key bit dependencies of the round key. So instead of attacks for all key sizes, they converted those attacks into attacks on only Clavier 128, but this time they work on 13 rounds, because they use the dependencies between the round key bits. But once we apply it to our attacks, our improbable differential attacks became better in terms of data and time complexity. And once we use the round key bit dependencies, we obtain the best 13 round attack on Clavier 128. So as far as I know, this is still the best attack on this cipher. And similarly, same observations can be made on the 14 and 15 round attacks on different key sizes. As you can see, there's also multi-dimensional zero correlation attacks by Bogdanov et al. But as you can see, these attacks have data complexity very close to whole codebook. And as far as I remember, a few years ago at an FSC conference, in some paper, they claimed that these attacks actually require more data complexity, which would exceed the whole codebook. So people claim that these attacks are not correct at all. So as you can see, attacks always get better and better. Here they started with 12 runs with this many data, but at the end we obtained 13 runs with data complexity even less than this, and with time complexity even less than the initial attack. So by observing some other property on the cipher, people might further improve these attacks and maybe obtain 14 round attack and so on. But since the cipher has 18 rounds, this doesn't cause any threat to the cipher. Instead, this shows that we can still have confidence on the security of the cipher. So crypto community actually works like this. Finding weaknesses on the reduced version shows that you can only break a limited part of the cipher. So you feel confident that the cipher will still be secure in the following years. But if these attacks gets better and better, and at some point, if you come close to 17 or 18 rounds, then your confidence would be lost. So in that case, standards sometimes change. So if there are other ciphers that are already in the while, let's say, that are analyzed for longer, they might become new standards, or like as the NIST does, people can have a competition and choose new ciphers once the previous standards are broken. But as far as we can see, Clafia will still be around for the following many years.